Welcome to Trinity Church Online. My name is Crystal, and we are so excited that you are joining us today. We have a wonderful experience planned for you, and we encourage you to gather your household to worship and listen together. Maybe you can even invite someone to church online by text or start a watch party. So get ready to join us for a time of worship. God is fine.
Cannot be shaken in the name. you, Jesus. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I know serves how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. Now I'm gonna see a victory, yes. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Now I'm gonna see a victory. Now I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, sing, church. There's power.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he wins. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy.
Maybe before we even receive communion, we should pray together. The Bible says that a man should examine himself, a woman should examine herself. Lord, just right now, if there's anything in any of us who are part of this communion service today, bring purity to our lives. Purify us, Lord, we pray. Cleanse our hearts in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Take the bread and just hold it as I read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 4, where the apostle writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" You know, church, this is a sacred time. It's a time of remembrance. You don't just hustle through this and forget it. While we're receiving the elements of Holy Communion, I want you to remember the cross. Remember the sacrifice. Remember that he lives forevermore today. Lord, as I hold this piece of bread, which represents the broken body of Christ, I pray that you would bless it. I give you thanks for your sacrifice. I pray that as I and my friends partake of this element today, that we would remember the tremendous sacrifice you made so that we could have healing, victory, resurrection life in this life. Bless it, we pray, in Christ's name. Shall we partake together? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The scripture goes on, if you take the cup with me, 1 Corinthians 11, 25 and 6. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Once again, that key word, both passages of scripture. When you do this, remember me, Jesus said. Lord, oftentimes at this moment, we think of the stripes that you bore on your backside. And you told us through the prophet, through the New Testament apostle, you told us that these stripes were for our healing. And today, Lord Jesus, I pray that as we partake of this cup, we would remember the price you pay for our salvation and our life here on earth, that it would be healed in Jesus' name to life more abundantly. Shall we partake of the cup today? Hallelujah. As we always do when we're together here in the house of God, say it with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, as we bring the communion time to a closing, I want to pray for you specifically. What is it right now that you're desperately in need of? Reach towards me. I'm telling you, friends, there's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in prayer. And when we agree, things happen in the heavenlies that are unexplainable here on earth. Pray with me, Father. I pray for my friend right now, in Jesus' name, that whatever chain they're bound with right now, as I pray and as I agree with them, according to Matthew 18:19, that chain would be broken, loosed, and they would be free in the name of Jesus. Touch them today. Bring healing. Bring a sound mind. Bring faith over fear. supply their every need. I pray today, Lord Jesus, I ask this in your precious, holy name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hey, Trinity Church, so glad that you're watching with us online today. It's a great Sunday for you to be here, because we're here. We're glad that you've joined us today, especially if it's your very first time. We consider you our VIP guest. If you could do us a favor and text Trinity VIP to 66866, there'll be a form sent to you that you can fill out. We're not going to do anything with your information besides use it to connect with you. We'd love for you to be a part of our Trinity Church family.
And whether it's your first time or you've been joining us for a long time, a great next step for you is Growth Track. Growth Track is a four-week course that we offer here at Trinity Church, where not only do you learn about Trinity, how we started, what we believe in, but you'll also learn about the gifts that God has given you to serve His house. So we encourage you to sign up today by texting Growth Track to 66866.
Yeah, and another way to connect is through our Connect Groups. Now, Connect Group season is happening right now. You can sign up right now for a Connect Group. There are men's groups, women's groups, co-ed groups, prayer groups, any type of group that you can think of, we probably have it for you. This is a great way to be a part of a community, get people to do life with, to pray with you, to love you, to help you on your journey of faith. If you'd like to join a Connect Group, you can text Connect Group to 66866. We'd love for you to be a part of one.
Absolutely. It's a great, great Sunday, and we're so excited that you are here. So for more, check out this week's news.
The ministry that God has placed on the Apostle Gustavo Paez is characterized by a supernatural movement of the Holy Spirit and a powerful prophetic gift with which he has impacted thousands of people throughout the world. Come and experience Apostle Gustavo Paez's ministry of prophetic healing and restoration. He will join us on Sunday, September 19th, including a 5:30 p.m. service. It will continue through Monday and Tuesday, September 20th and September 21st at 7:30 p.m. We hope you join us.
And now we've come to the wonderful opportunity that we have to worship the Lord with our giving. You know, the mission that God has called us to is to win the lost, help the poor, and teach the abundant life. And the way we reach our mission is all of us agreeing together. According to Matthew 18, verse 19, when we agree together, we create an atmosphere for miracles. Did you ever think of that before? So you say, Pastor Robin, agree on what? What do you mean? You know what that is? It's our seven core values. Right here at Trinity Church, number one, our first core value is Jesus is our message. Number two, people are our heart. Three, generosity is a privilege. Four, excellence is our spirit. Five, servant leadership is our identity. Six, honor is our calling. And number seven, passion is our pursuit. Don't you love those? I do. Yes, that's what we value here at Trinity Church. Now, if all of us who say we belong stay in agreement with each other, God's word promises that we're going to move forward, no matter how stuck you might feel. And that's what we are doing. We can't rest on what we've done yesterday or any time in our past. You know, the future is staring us right in the face, and it's a new beginning. You know, at Trinity Church, you and I give our tithes and our offerings, our time and our talent to continually promote the gospel story. But we can't accomplish the mission if only a few people of the church participate. You and I, we're to preach. You and I, we are the church, not the building. That's not the church. You and I are the church, and we together are on mission. We have a culture that must be spread all over the city and all over the county and all over the world. It's your opportunity and my privilege to be able to serve the Lord in our giving. And again, How? With our time in servant leadership, with our talent in servant leadership, and with our finances, our treasure. You know, right on the screen, you can see all the ways that you can participate. And I encourage you to just automate it. That's what my husband and I do. It just, every week, digitally, our tithe just happens. It's first, it's easy, it's simple, and it keeps us consistent. I gotta tell you, God's a big God. He has big ideas for you and me, and I want my world to be generous. I know you do too. So let's pray. Father, we lift up your tithes, our offerings, and we say thank you one more time for taking care of us, bringing us through. And God, we know that as we give back a portion of what you've given to us, we are planting into our own financial future the security of your word and your promise. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. And now let's join the worship team and continue to worship with them.
I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets. Folks are key to making things happen at Trinity Church. And I want you, like we always do, to welcome this wonderful man of God, Pastor YPJ from South Bend, Indiana. Great church in South Bend, Indiana. God bless you, Pastor.
Would you clap your hands as hard as you can for Jesus Christ all over the room? And if you got a little energy, somebody give God a shout while you clap your hands. Amen. Before you sit down, I need everybody in this room to let me know how you feel about your pastors by making some noise in this house right now. I am so delighted to be with you all. It is an honor and a privilege to be in Miami, to be in Florida. Y'all state is so controversial right now. Everybody's kind of scared to come here, fooling with y'all. But I'm delighted to be here, and I thank God for Pastor Rich and his lovely wife who has on this sequence that's just working tonight. But they are just incredible people, incredible individuals. Pastor Rich has become one of my favorite people, and whenever he reaches out, I'm always available. Now, let me let you know this about Pastor Rich. He's going to keep asking you for more and more things. It doesn't matter what he think he's slick. He'll call me, "Hey, man. Why, I just need one little favor." You're like, "All right, whatever you want, Pastor Rich, whatever. I'm going to do it anyway." So I thank God for him. I thank God for his family. Aren't you blessed to have such great leaders in this amazing church, Trinity? Now, I want to challenge your thinking. And so more than likely, if you're a traditionalist who does not sway from your intellectual understanding of Scripture, you will most likely at some point be disturbed by something that I say. My moral is, in the whole story, is simply this: if I can challenge you to go home and study, then I've done my job. So I want you to be like, "I don't like that," but then you got to go study and see if I'm right or you wrong, all right? But I appreciate you. Would you grab your Bibles? I want you to look at a verse with me very quickly, the book of Matthew, chapter number 6 and verse number 19. In the New Living Translation, Matthew chapter number 6 and verse number 19. Thank you so much for all of the amazing hospitality. You guys have a stellar hospitality team here at Trinity Church, and so we thank God for them. They've done an amazing job. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 19, in the NLT, it says, "Don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasure in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also." Wherever your treasure is, there is the desire of your heart. Father, give me the wisdom, the clarity, and the brief nature to deliver this word with accuracy in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. All right, let's go to work. So you need to understand, in this passage of scripture that we've just read, Jesus, in his articulation and ability to accurately break down the will of God, says to humanity, "It is not a good thing for you to amass great amounts of wealth and let it sit." It isn't that he has an issue with you having great wealth. Listen to this. He has an issue with you attaining purposeless wealth. Everybody listen to that statement. Purposeless wealth. Warren Buffett makes a statement that's absolutely phenomenal, and I think most people who know anything about finances will respect Warren Buffett for the mere fact that he's a billionaire. But he says, "Excessive wealth has no utility," which means that when you amass a large amount of wealth with no purpose attached to it, there's no reason to really have it. The thought process is, come here, church, in America, that we are a country that has to have poverty. This is the thought process. We just can't get around poverty. How is that even a possibility? When you have individuals who own 4 and 5 yachts, Don't get quiet now. I'm a black preacher. You got to talk back to me. How is that possible when we're paying athletes $600 and $700 million contracts to play sports? There is no need for poverty in our country, nor is there a need for poverty in the world. The issue is not a lack of provision. Come here. The issue is a lack of distribution. The problem is there are too many people who have amassed, listen, purposeless wealth, who do not understand the reality or the accountability or the responsibility associated with the increase God desires to distribute. All right, I'm excited to preach because whenever you talk about money, now we find out where your heart is. See, when we say, shout unto God with a voice of triumph, hallelujah! Like somebody give God a praise, hallelujah! Let's raise an offering. Here we go again. We got things to do. Jesus says, I don't have an issue with you gaining. I have an issue when what you have has you. He says, so here's the problem. I can't test your heart until we put you in a position where you have to release what you think matters. You ready? Your heart can't be tested until money is requested. That's why this whole vision video, because you know y'all rich at this church. I got a big old movie screen back here. At my church, we got an iPad. Everybody got to just do this and look from far. It was a full production. White Jesus up there, everything was great. It was like, this is amazing. But when the conversation went forward about the necessity of taking care of God's house, the opinions and the concerns within ourselves make our ears dull. Well, I mean, I know they need an air conditioner at the church, but I need an air conditioner at my house. I got to take care of my house first. This lets me know that your heart is now disturbed because a request was made and it upset you. It was a request that was made for ministry and for kingdom. And for some, it upset you. For others, you became intrigued. And you said, wait, what can I do to assist in the effort? Jesus says, wherever a man's treasure is, his heart is connected. I tell my church this all the time. Don't tell me, young man, that you love your children but will buy Jordans before you buy diapers. Because what you've revealed to me is where your heart really is. You cannot tell the condition of an individual's heart until you ask them to give up something. You've heard the story of the young rich ruler. And they've made him out to be this villain, like he's this horrible young man. When the truth is, he was an outstanding young man. The scripture says, and you all have heard the story, I'm sure, and if you haven't, I'm glad to introduce it to you, that a young man comes to Jesus, and he says, Master, what must I do to be your disciple to inherit eternal life? He says, listen, I've kept the law since I was a little boy. Jesus says, good. Now watch this. This is how we can tell his character and his integrity has some validity. Because if he has attempted, because no man could do it, to keep the law, he honored both his mother and his father. The Bible says that is the first commandment that is given with promise. So he submitted himself to the teaching of, I honor my mother and my father. All right. If that being the case, he did not steal. He did not kill. He did not physically commit adultery. He did nothing that was displeasing. Jesus says, you've done well. But there's one issue. He says, you rich, aren't you? He said, yes, Lord. He said, take all that you have. Wait for this. He said, and I want you to sell it. Now, I don't believe, and this is just me talking as a bald-head, light-skinned guy, I don't believe that he had a problem with selling all that he had. Because if he was a submitted young man to his mother and his father, he had been taught to submit to authority. So most likely, even if he was not happy about it, he was willing to do what Jesus said because he came with the intention of becoming a disciple and being submitted to Jesus. So he says to him, take everything you have and sell it. Okay, God. Now, here's where I believe the issue came in. It wasn't that Jesus told him that he had to sell his things. It's where Jesus told him to give. He said, take all you have and give it to the poor. Then the young man looked and said, wait, You expect me to take all that I've worked so hard to accumulate and hand it over to people I don't even have a relationship with? Now, oh, y'all quiet. But you know you would be emotionally troubled if Pastor Rich came to you and said, the Lord told me to tell you, wipe out your entire bank account. You see that homeless guy over there? Go give all that money to him. Now you see it in perspective? He looks and he goes, but I have so much. He didn't have an issue with the so much until the so much was told to be distributed to where the kingdom was prioritizing. The kingdom priority was those who did not have enough. The kingdom priority was giving to those who were in great lack. Wait for it. The kingdom priority was giving to those who did not necessarily deserve it. And so now this young man is depressed and he walks away. And what did he reveal in that moment? His heart. Here's the problem. He missed the principle. When it was all said and done and he begins to walk away, Jesus starts teaching. He says, it's very difficult for a rich man to enter into heaven. But when he talks about the eye of a needle, there's a theological debate, and I'm sure Pastor Rich has taught it to you about whether or not they're actually talking about a space or a place in the home country where a camel could barely make it through or whatever. Whatever the case, he said it is very challenging, not because having wealth is the issue, wealth having you is the issue. And they thought that they could purchase salvation, but it was not possible to be done that way. Here's what the Lord says. He says, anybody that gives up everything in this lifetime for me, whether that's houses, land, family, etc., it makes no difference. He says, you will receive in this life this hundredfold blessing with persecution. Pay attention. He says, I will bless you in this life if you're willing to give up for me in this life. Now understand, when you receive the blessing that I truly have for you, it comes with hate. Everybody, I'm looking for my next level. Well, get ready for your next devil, because there is always going to be a connection. I want to be wealthy, but with purpose. Yeah, Jesus says, the young man didn't realize had he obeyed me, I would have given him more than what he had acquired. His confidence is what in what he acquired and didn't realize there was a treasury in heaven that never runs out. Now, I'm not talking about speaking in tongues. I'm talking about literally there was a transfer from the invisible realm into the visible realm. For the Bible says the things that we see are made from things that we do not see, which means that your wealth is the product of what you have believed in your faith realm. It can be transferred over into the natural realm. So when you believe God, he says, I'm able to take things from a treasury you didn't even know exists and bring it into your hands. The young man missed his blessing because of his unwillingness to submit his heart to the request that had been made for vision. The Lord gave him vision. Let's help the poor. He said, I can't do it, and walked away. Jesus is teaching. He says, wherever your treasure is, there's your heart also. There's a passage in the book of Luke where Jesus tells a story about a man who builds barns. And he fills all of these enormous barns up that he has with corn and with harvest. And when he gets done and he fills them to maximum capacity, it's interesting because they ask him, Master, huh, what are you going to do now? He said, I'll tell you what. Watch this. I want you to tear down the barns we've already built, build bigger ones, and fill them to capacity. And then they did it. They said, what now? He said, oh, it's all good. Now we can just sit back, relax, because we have accumulated great wealth for years to come. And then God speaks. Well, what did God say to him, Pastor YPJ? God said, you fool. He called a man who in the eyes of the world would have been considered wise because of his accumulation of a massive wealth. God looks at him and says, you fool. Your soul is required of you this night. Or in other words, you have wealth, but it had no purpose. You thought that your security was in what you had accumulated and what you had amassed. I think it's interesting that some of you have amassed, you've acquired such a small amount of nothing, and yet you hold it like it's God. I got $5,000 in the bank. Really? I know you discovered the Robin Hood app and you've invested $200 and you think you are a stocks market genius now. You got the Fidelity app and yeah, girl, I just made $22 yesterday on Tesla. I got Bitcoin, Dogecoin. So small. And the enemy is taunting you while Satan's children are trillionaires. wasting revenue because of a kingdom lack of understanding when it comes to the distribution of wealth. That with God, he never leaves, watch this, a person who genuinely believes him and trusts him with less. You ready for it? You ready for it? The Bible says that Paul speaks and he gives us this understanding. What? He says, God is a giver. How so? God gives seed to the sower. Y'all ready? He says he gives seed to the sower, not seed to the selfish. Here's the problem. You're asking God for increase and God is asking you why. God, I declare increase over my house. Why? So you can buy another TV? This church is different. I don't know about your church. My church got them stimulus checks and went straight to Sam's Club. Man, oh, I'm about to get the 37,000-inch television, Pastor. I'm like, why don't you set up a trust fund? Because we're not thinking of legacy. We're considering our own selfish gratification. Yeah, and so when we talk about the distribution of revenue, we talk about sowing into vision, immediately opinion pushes aside obedience. We start to consider our own desire, not realizing that God is smiling at you. He's laughing and he's testing you because he wants to know, what does your heart do when vision is displayed in front of you and when you are asked to be a part of something bigger than you? Well, I gave last year. That's last year. I dare you go to the electric company tomorrow and tell them, you know what, I would pay my bill this month, but I paid it last month. They're going to tell you, go to Bath and Body Works, get some candles, because you're finna be without lights. Get a real nice smell good one, mahogany teak woods, you're going to be. God is saying, but what are you doing now? And so when I look at that passage of scripture and I consider what's being stated, it reveals to me that the Lord is looking for those whom he can trust with treasure, that understand that having wealth comes with purpose. And those who have purposeless wealth are considered sinners in the eyes of God and fools. The Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children, which means that even while he's acquiring wealth, he's considering the next generation. His wealth has purpose. His thoughts are, I'm accumulating so that I can pay for college so they won't have student loans. I'm accumulating so that when he gets his first house and he gets her or she gets her first home, that they can come to granddad and grandmom and say, I need my down payment or I need this amount. I'll have it ready for you. Because everything that I acquire has a purpose associated and attached to it. It is not simply for my own gratification. God is not blessing me to splurge. He's blessing me to serve. You know what? I'm preaching better than y'all talking. Let me pat myself on the back right there. Look at your neighbor, and I need you to talk to him. And if you're scared, just put your hand over your mouth, and you don't give him no, you know, whatever. But tell him, say, God's blessing you to serve, not splurge. God's blessing you to serve. Some of y'all didn't talk to your neighbor. It must have been your spouse. Y'all get over it and get over it. Be nice. Swish. You know I'm not talking to you right now. He's blessed you to serve. Now, is splurging a sin? Not at all when you understand how things go. But we live in a society right now, and I get it. Pastor Robin, I get it. People don't believe the Bible anymore. Now, unfortunately, it's not all their fault. Because, you know, everybody like, people just don't believe that word. That's because it's been taught wrong. It has been utilized to manipulate people into giving them their money. Manipulate people into being indentured servants in the house of the Lord. But when you are a part, thank you, Holy Ghost, of a ministry that throughout the years has proven consistency in their willingness to serve the community, how are you still questioning vision? Now, see, I got a few of y'all clapping right now, but how are you questioning? Because if Trinity wasn't about nothing, then how is it that it's still expanding? How, thank you, Lord, and I know this mic sounds real good. How did Trinity survive the pandemic when other churches were shutting down and closing? Because this isn't Pastor Rich's church, and this isn't Pastor Robin's church. No, this is the church of the living God. And if it's the church of the living God, that means he's placed people on the inside of it to push vision forward. And y'all know the Bible, without vision, the people perish. That literally means without clarity. And without kingdom insight, the people go around without any understanding or direction. They're literally just existing. And I have discovered that there are many people in this day and age that are just existing. They have absolutely no purpose and no reason behind what they do. And God is saying, why are you asking me for a bigger house? I don't have a problem giving it to you, but do you understand the why? God, I'm believing you for a promotion. Yes, but why? Are you doing it so you can slap a photo filter on and get 20 more likes on your IG page? Or are you actually doing this because you're saying, Lord, if you increase me, I'll pay off student loans. If you increase me, I'll go to the hospital and make sure that they have all that they need. If, y'all ain't talking, if you increase me, I will go to the worst neighborhood in this city and say, how can I be of help? This is how it works. Because most of y'all ain't going over to the hood. You're like, I don't go over there. This is why you connect with kingdom community. Because the church always has things in position and in place to go the places you won't go. So what am I supposed to do? Fuel the vision. How do I fuel it? Finance it. It's called ecumenical. Finance it. I'll give you an example. In my city, South Bend, Indiana, there's a Catholic church, St. Augustine. They have a soup kitchen. Their soup kitchen is phenomenal. There is a man that came and said, why doesn't this church, talking about my church, have a soup kitchen? I said, sir, I don't go to your house and ask you why you don't have air conditioning. I need you to... I'm a smart aleck. You can't just come say something to me. He said, why don't you have a soup kitchen? I said, first of all, you came at me with criticism and a contentious spirit. But let me help you, Jethro. Around the corner is St. Augustine. They already have a soup kitchen. So what we do is we buy the soup. Y'all got to help me. We write them the check to make sure they can keep serving. Because if we have ministry in the city already that's available across the street from us, then why are we competing to see who can give out more soup than us collaborating together so that the vision comes to be? The problem is people don't care about results. They want credit. Woo, I think I'm going to get invited back here because I just felt the Holy Ghost on that one. A lot of y'all won't give unless somebody say, well, you know, Brother Johnson gave $10,000. Okay, Brother Johnson, thank you. You got your little shout out. But when it's all said and done, it's not about credit. It's about results. Did we save a young man from being murdered in the street? Did we save a young woman from losing herself to the street? Did we make impact and effort? Well, Pastor, I don't have a lot. You have more than many. All I have is $100 that I can spare in this moment. That $100 is something that would be a benefit to someone else. So the Lord is saying, if I can trust you to sow the $100 seed, what you're revealing to me is I can trust you with anything. Why do you say that, preacher? The Bible says, he that is faithful over a little bit shall be made ruler over much. There's no in between. That means if I can trust you, God says, if I can trust you to give me the little bit, I can bless you with a seed that's so big, it's bigger than the check you bring home every week. How many of you want to be at a place where you can give more than what you make? Y'all didn't hear what I just said. You want to be in a position that you can be a blessing beyond a blessing. So prove that to God with what you have. Prove that to God with what you have. When you hear vision, when you hear that there is a collaborative effort, you have to say, Lord, what is it that I can do? We partner with the church across the street. My brother, Pastor Kenneth Lee, who is a councilman in our city, he is also a pastor of an incredible church. He and I were conversing one day at lunch. He said, man, there are kids in our community that are being bullied and being mocked because they cannot wash their clothes. And so because it's a uniform community in our school system, they have to wear the same shirt every day, and it carries a heavy odor. He said they go in and the kids mock them and they make fun of them and they can't go to the laundromat because their mama can't even put quarters together. And I sat back and I said, okay, this ain't gonna work. What can we do? He sat back. He said, man, I had a vision. I said, what's the vision? He said, the schools now don't have as many teachers and students, so there's 3 or 4 empty classrooms in each school. I said, okay. He said, I had a vision of us putting a laundromat in one of the classrooms. He said, but the school said they won't finance it. I said, give me 5 minutes. I called my CFO. I said, I need you to get in contact with Sister So-and-so. She works for Whirlpool there in our city. I said, collaborate with them. Find out how much it would cost for us to buy washers and dryers, and then I need you to call Pastor Lee. Y'all collaborate and see what it would take to put a laundromat in the school. 3 weeks later, they had a laundromat in one of the elementary schools. The mamas, the daddies could come and wash. Their kids were happy. The other schools found out about it and said, we need the same thing. I called my CFO. I feel the Holy Ghost. I said, we got to do it again. And then when I got to the point that the money was running low, I stood up. I said, let me talk to all of y'all in here that's got rims on your cars and gold in your teeth. I need you to stop taking care of yourself. I need you to walk down here and give me $1,000. You want to show all the ladies you got money? Show them you got money right now. Write me a check so I can buy a washing machine. All the dope boys walk down there. Here you go, Pastor. Thank you, Ray Ray. And now we've started something in the city. Watch this. When the news cameras showed up, Pastor Rich, I wasn't there. My CFO wasn't there. My team wasn't there. The councilman was there. The principals were there. And my councilman called me. He said, hey, man, you need to get here so the people can know who did this. I said, no, because I don't care about credit. I care about results. See, if I get in front of that camera, they'll think I'm the one that did it. No, this is the Holy Ghost doing. This is the will of God. If they see you, then another pastor will be inspired. Then another businessman will be inspired because I need results. God put us in a position that, no, we don't have the laundromat in our church. We financed it in the school. But see, a lot of times you don't think that way. Your thought process is, see, the problem is we need to get out here and march. Okay, you go out and march. And there's nothing wrong with that. You should go march because God calls you to march. God called me to sit with the mayor. So after you get done marching, now me and the mayor can talk about the policy that you're looking to happen through your march. Everybody isn't assigned to the same thing, but if we do our part. Jesus is giving them vision. He's explaining to them, do not amass a large amount of wealth that does not have purpose. Don't be proud of what you've accumulated. There's a barber in our city. I love him. He is probably 80 years old now. The worst barber alive. He never got better. He stopped learning how to cut in the 50s. He just never got. He's still in there with some scissors. You want an afro, sir? That's not even a thing right now. But he's invested in stocks and bonds. And he always brings his little paper portfolio out. Pastor, man, look, man, I didn't accumulate $8 million. Man, this dude is a millionaire, lives in the hood. Millionaire. He's like, look what I've accumulated. I'm like, that's awesome. And what, I want to ask him, what are you going to do with it? You're 80 years old. It's almost time. I'm messing with some of y'all like, oh, my God. You finna take the trip. I'm sorry. I said, I want to ask. So his prodigy, who is my best friend, he's running the barbershop now. And he keeps telling, he's like, bro, listen, y'all, how many of y'all ever seen Coming to America? His barbershop looked like that barbershop. Steel. With the big, I promise y'all, it looks like that barbershop. It looks like it did in the 60s. And they're like, yo, Pop, we need to get this redone. Oh, no, we'll be fine. He's sitting with purposeless wealth. Here's what he doesn't understand. The moment God calls him home, and that money is really his kids finna spend. So you lived your whole life holding on to something, not enjoying life. I have another friend of mine, his father, incredible man. He's now 80-something years old. He's getting older, and he's slowing down. And one day we were sitting on the couch, and I looked at him. I said, Pop, man, he's accumulated a lot of money. I said, Pop, man, you don't never do nothing, man. You know, what you going to do with your life? He looked at me. He says, you know why, P? I've always wanted to go to Hawaii. I said, well, go. He said, no, I'm waiting on a rainy day. I said, you keep on waiting. It's raining right now. But it hurt me because I'm thinking to myself, you 80-something years old. Hawaii is there, and you got the money to go. Watch this. Y'all ready? But he had become obsessed with saving to whereas his accumulation had become his God, and he couldn't part. Y'all ready for me? The longer it takes you to get it, the harder it is to let it go. And the reason why is you never learned along the way that as you accumulate, you still distribute. See, because if all you do is accumulate without distribution, you begin to worship the accumulate. I'm trying to help you. There are some of you right now who still scream broke and you got six figures sitting in a savings account.
I ain't got no money.
Because your money got you. If you check your bank account every day and just look at it. I love you, money. Pastor Rich and I were talking about it when I came out, and I've always said this to my church. He agrees the same statement he makes. On your dollar bill, it says, in God we trust. That's not Jehovah. It's the money they're talking. In God we trust. The money. That's the God. People say this. The Bible says you cannot worship God in money. Actually, it says you cannot worship God in mammon. Mammon is not money. Mammon is a principality. It is the demonic spirit that oversees capital. Now, notice that Jesus did not say you cannot worship God and the devil. Because the devil is not the major influence in this world. His servant, Mammon, is. Mammon is the demonic principality that oversees capital, and he's the one that entices you. And, watch this, he can bless you. Y'all got quiet. That's the reason why the rappers get up, man, I want to thank God. They don't even realize God didn't give you that. That was a principality that distributed to you. But the problem with the principality blessing you is there is always an undertone clause. There's always something in the fine line that you did not read, you did not see. And it's just as quick as they give it to you, they'll take it from you. Watch this. This is why it seems like people who serve the devil get blessed faster. Because demons are not on a timeline. They're rushing. They know they have a short time. The reason why it seems like it takes longer when you live for God is because angels have to move according to the plan of God. And the angels know that even though there is no rush, because rushing leads to ruin, if you would be patient, it leads to permanence. I got to develop your character before I give you the increase. Because if I don't develop your character, the increase will consume you. I need a church. I feel like tap dancing on that. I hope you understand what I'm saying to you this evening. We've been given vision. We've been given vision. When I walk up the stage, I'm going to text my CFO and let them know that we will be sowing into Trinity Church. And I want to start this evening by sowing $1,500 just from our church into what you're doing. Here's the thing. Preachers don't come to give money. Preachers come to get the money. I need 1,000 people standing in this line right here. Shake my hand and give me $28. The Lord said, 28, the month of February, God's going to give you new love. Some of y'all, yes, Lord, I knew it. You shouting out there with $28, my husband is coming. No, he ain't. Your $28 husband ain't talking about nothing. You got a $28 husband. I need to grow up. I'm sorry. Oh, Jesus, let's worship. But hear my heart. Wherever the wonderful keyboard player is, they can come right now. Hear my heart. And I really, really mean this when I say it. This church has shown us what can be done. I believe, Pastor Rich, that the true foundation of a ministry is proven by its extension. And even though Trinity is the mothership, the development of the ministry has been in its expansion. The campuses that have come from this house and the lives that are being touched from this house. And so we know that God is with this house. But there are many of you that have become relaxed and passive. I'm prophesying now. And the Lord is saying, how could you be passive and relaxed? And I'm not talking to everybody, but there are those of you that in a time of quote-unquote pandemic, you prospered more than you had ever prospered in your entire life. You saw it. You looked at your resources and said, I should have less, but I have more. It doesn't make sense. And God says, I'm trying to show you I'm your source. The problem is, in the midst of all of this, many of you forgot. Oh, God, when you was broke, if you would just bless me, Lord. I'll do X, Y, Z, and God is staring at you now saying, what happened to your end of the deal? What happened to your bargain? Why do we have to beg people in the kingdom to push kingdom vision? Are you just proud that you make more money than everybody in the church, or are you saying the Lord has empowered me to be a pillar, lead, catalyst giver, that I can stand up and say, I'm giving 10,000, I'm giving 20,000. Our last sowing Sunday when I stood up, I said, I'm going to start off, I'm going to give $10,000. I didn't do that because I wanted to boast that I gave $10,000 in church. I gave $10,000 in hopes and in prayers that in the years ahead, I could write a check for $150,000 without batting an eye. Because as cute as I am now, 12 years ago, I went through a very public divorce, not because of infidelity and not because of anything domestic. We were two young people who were raised in church, and church taught you to get married but didn't teach you how to stay married. It's better to marry than to burn. Okay, well, neither one of us burned, and we ain't married. And so we didn't make it. And when it was all said and done, this young pastor who had a thriving church in the city, taken over for his father, people mocked and made fun and said, he'll never survive this. He'll never make it through this. And because of who I am, I wanted to make sure she was all right, make sure the family was all right. And so I made sure to take care of them, which left me with no resource whatsoever. And I remember when the divorce was over with, literally having to move to the church. People thought I was having all-night prayer meetings. No, I was asleep. They was like, he's dedicated to the Lord. No, I'm homeless. I can laugh now. I wasn't laughing then. They thought I was in there speaking in tongues. I was in there crying. And I remember literally being in the office saying, God, I've served you. How did I end up here? How did I end up here? How did I end up here? How did life happen to me? And there's a lot of you in this room that would say, Pastor, you don't understand. Life has happened to me. No, I totally understand. I totally understand what it's like to go to ministries, raise money for them, encourage them, preach and prophesy to them. And then when I went through my divorce, they treated me like a leper. When I needed them to pray for me, I can't touch you. I thank God for my biological parents and my spiritual parents. They're the ones that nurtured, raised me. My father is my bishop, and they stuck by me. The church stuck by me. The church continued to grow, continued to thrive, and I would preach every week, and God began to expand my name even though I was still broken. I remember days where I would preach so hard intentionally so I would sweat. That way the people couldn't see me cry. They thought I was sweating and I was crying my eyes out because I watched married couples reconcile over the prophetic word that God gave me while my marriage was gone. This happened. I'm going through all of this and expected to serve God. During that time frame while I'm broken and I can't figure out what I'm going to do and how things are going to go, let me show you how God works so you will understand why you have to obey God. I'm doing what God is telling me to do even though I'm in a broken place. God ends up connecting me to Fred Hammond. Those of you that know who that is, an amazing gospel artist. Fred Hammond calls because I write music, I do music. He says, hey, man, I want you to come down to Dallas. I fly down to Dallas while I'm broke. Had to put it all on my credit card. Didn't know how I was going to get there. Made it down there. We sit down. We work together. We write a song called I Feel Good. I Feel Good gets nominated for a Grammy. I get my first Grammy nomination while I'm broke. Broke. Walking in obedience. Watch this. Everybody sees me on TV. Look at him. He's got a Grammy nom. They didn't realize that we had to go to In-N-Out Burger afterwards because I didn't have. There's so many people that look blessed, but they're still broken. But I had to keep going and trusting God. And I said to the Lord, how am I going to get out of this? And one day the Lord spoke to me while I'm broke. He says, I want you to sow $1,000. And I said, Satan, they don't understand. I can laugh now, dog. I can laugh. It wasn't funny then. You ever said, people literally say this to God, but I ain't got but $1,000, God. I ain't got but a. You know you country. I ain't got butter. But I gave it. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me that day. That's when he revealed to me who he was. He says, you think that I put you in this position to make you suffer? No. I don't want you to suffer. He says, son, I need you to realize that your religion can't help you in times of crisis. You attending church can't help you in times of crisis. Singing on the praise team. He said, what is the posture of your heart? Because God said, I'm not looking for perfection. I'm looking for posture. What is the posture of your heart? And I said, Lord, my heart is towards you. He said, then give me your money. Because your heart can't be tested until money is requested. He said, who do you trust? I said, I trust you. Gave him $1,000. From that point forward, the Lord began to favor me in ways that I cannot explain. Where doors began to open up for me, young man from South Bend, Indiana, where he began to expand and make my name great. Pastor Rich was teasing me earlier. He said, man, you run with everybody. And I, to this day, don't know how that has happened. Where I ended up being a chaplain for the NFL. I ended up being a leader in many of the universities in the country where they bring me into Fortune 500 companies and ask me to speak. I remember the first time I was drawn out to one of the, flew out to one of the major universities. And they had me do a motivational speech for like 35 minutes. And I think I was at the time maybe 32, 33 years old. And I was like, oh, you know, I'm just going to do this speech. And I got done with the speech. And then they were like, thank you so much for coming. They handed me the check. And I almost asked them, did y'all make a mistake? Because I only spoke for 30 minutes. And this is how much I made last year. And God says, get used to it. Because you've given me your heart now. I can trust you. And I'm looking, y'all, last year during the pandemic, 2 years ago, I had bought a brand new home, beautiful home, loved it, beautiful home, loved it. Home of my dreams. Oh, this is a 5-bedroom, 4-bathroom, beautiful. This house is huge, huge backyard, quiet neighborhood. I had made it. I was like the man with the barns. I can lay back now. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me one day while I was sitting in my home during the pandemic. Everybody's stressed out. God says to me, this isn't your home. And of course, I got deep. That's right. Heaven is my home. He said, no. We're supposed to laugh, y'all. He says, no, this isn't your home. Watch this. He said, I want you to give your house to your little sister. And again, who did I talk to? Satan. My sister, who is a phenomenal artist. Her name is Mickey Miller, incredible singer, incredible artist. Had a husband, his name is Martell, my little brother. He was diagnosed with MS many years ago. Couldn't move, couldn't walk, couldn't feed himself, couldn't speak, couldn't breathe. They have 3 daughters. She had been pushing and pressing and striving, couldn't get a home because of the financial situation of her family. God blessed me with this beautiful 5-bedroom home, 4 bathrooms, large kitchen, everything about it was splendiferous. And here I am, single, no kids, chilling. And God said, give it to your sister. I called my mother. I said, God just told me to give Mickey my house. And she said, obey God. Now, some of y'all, that's honorable. Do you know how hard? Some of y'all won't give God $10. And God asked me for my house in a pandemic. I called my sister. I said, come see me right now. She met up with me at the church. She said, what's up, bro? I said, God told me to give you this. She's looking. I said, she's like, what? I said, this is the keys to the house. She breaks down. She's crying. I'm crying too, but it's not the same tears. It looks synonymous. Can you just be honest? Sometimes your yes is painful. Now watch this, y'all. I give my sister the house. She's excited. Her daughters are grabbing me. Uncle Jay, we love you so much. I'm so excited. My dad, he's not an emotional man. He got a tear falls down. Everybody's so excited. Now watch this. When I was in the house, the Lord told me put a TV in every bedroom. Yes, Lord. Tell me put brand new furniture in every room. Yes, Lord. Get the basement done. Yes, Lord. I get everything done, not realizing it wasn't for me. It was for them. 3 weeks after they get the house, her husband dies. Family's devastated. The Holy Ghost speaks to me and says, now do you see why I told you settle them? Because I was calling him home, but now they have somewhere to go and recover and be rejuvenated and be refreshed. And they tell me all the time, Uncle Jay, if it wasn't for us having this space in this place, it would have been hard. I didn't have nowhere to go now. I'm homeless again. And now I got money and I'm homeless. And so I asked the Lord, what am I to do? God said, move in with your parents. I could stop my whole sermon right there. I'm 43 years old. And my mom and dad are empty nesters. They got a beautiful home. They acted like they was excited I was coming back, not realizing I was about to be their indentured servant. They're like, oh, yeah, come on back. My dad's like, hey, you on your way home? Yeah, well, stop by the barbecue place to grab it. Give me a slab of ribs and a side of fries with a ranch on the side. Long story short, the Lord blesses me with a house twice as big as the one I gave away in the neighborhood, I know this is sad, where they have never allowed any black people to live. I'm the first black person to ever live in this neighborhood. It's not a good thing per se, but it's tearing down walls of divide. And the neighbors are coming over, and they were scared at first, y'all. Some of them, they older, they were scared. They was walking like, hi, how are you? I was like, hi, you know, I'm over there. So, hi, Bridget, how are you today? And now I'm a rock star. They act like they jogging by because they want to see, there's the black guy. Hey, Jamal, it's Jonathan, thank you. The point is this, when it's all said and done, when you trust God, he will never leave you less than what you have given up. But I needed to put that in your spirit. Excessive wealth has no utility. God wants to increase you with purpose. Let me pray over you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Every person that has heard me today, even as Pastor Rich prepares to continue casting vision, I pray you would prick their heart. And I heard you tell me that our church will start and sow a $1,500 seed. That may not be the last seed, but it's our first seed. And we are going to be a part of this moment of vision. I pray for every person that's in a position to give $10,000, $15,000, $20,000, $30,000, that they would not struggle, but they will say, Lord, it is not about credit. It is about this being done. I declare in Jesus' name. That every person that feels bad and says, well, all I have is $300. No, ain't no all you have. Say, Lord, I'm excited to give you my $300. I'm excited to give you my $150. I'm excited to give you my $700, my $1,000. But I pray for that person that's been holding on to what God has been telling you to give. Obey God and watch him work on your behalf. And when you trust him, he will reveal to you the true treasures of heaven. And we thank you for it now. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. I uproot doubt right now in Jesus' name. And I declare that you will be confident in your investment in the kingdom. In Jesus' name, I need you to clap your hands as hard as you can all over this room. God is great.
Can I get an amen? That was one of the most powerful prophetic words on generosity I've ever heard in my entire life. We're planning for the long haul. This isn't about, well, we're almost done, so we'll let the next generation take care of. No. No, we'll take care of our stuff on our watch. Amen? And you can say, well, Pastor, how are we still going? We planted 2-3 mega churches in the last 6 years, and we're still here. You've been faithful. You've done what he talked about doing tonight. But I'm going to ask you to stretch a little more. Some of you will stretch your faith to pledge $100. But I'm going to ask every one of you, husband and wife, all right? If you wanted to be together and not separate, put both names on the deal. But pledge something. This is our theme for 2022, amen? We're going to win, church. Hallelujah. Now, Lord, speak to your people to do the impossible again, because we know that through you it's possible. Lord, speak to hearts as to maybe they should change what they were going to give and believe you for even more. Bless your people in Christ's name.